Thank you, everyone, for coming. My name's Michelle Nichols. I'm the Reuters correspondent here at the United Nations. And due to the panel that we're, the subject of the panel that we have today, I'm going to ask every member of the panel to say which gender pronoun they use. So I'm a she. As a journalist, this panel on legal reforms to protect the human rights of trans, intersex, and gender variant people is very timely. In the United States, of course, the issue of whether transgender people can use bathrooms that correspond to their gender identity has been back in the headlines. Pakistani activists accused police in Saudi Arabia of beating to death two transgender women from Pakistan who had been arrested. Saudi Arabia has denied these allegations. And in Brazil, of course, the killing of a transgender woman, Dandandra dos Santos, gained international attention after the horrific cell phone video of her being beaten was circulated on the internet. But there are some glimmers of hope. In February, Ecuadorian transgender people were allowed to vote for the first time according to their chosen gender, and the Boy Scouts of America accepted its first transgender member. And so now we're going to hear about some of the things that have been done to protect the rights of trans, intersex, and gender variant people, and what more needs to be done. So to start, I'm going to turn the floor over to Helena, Dalli, the Minister for Social Dialogue, Consumer Affairs, and Civil Liberties of the Republic of Malta. So, Minister, perhaps you could start by telling us your gender pronoun.
Yes, cisgender. Okay, it's a she. I'm very, very, very pleased to welcome as many of you to this important side event, even considering the time that this event is being held. I'm very glad that it's well attended. So we're here to discuss the situation of sex gender minorities, namely trans, intersex, and gender variant people, and discuss legal reforms to protect their human rights. When I became minister in 2013, a post-op transsexual was still fighting for her right to marry her heterosexual partner in front of the European Court of Human Rights because the reasoning of the national court was that it could not determine her sex. I addressed this gap in our laws and within the first month of my mandate amended the provisions to our civil code to allow her and others like her to marry without difficulty. The following year, we introduced sexual orientation and gender identity in our national constitution's anti-discrimination article and started working on a law to recognize trans, intersex, and gender variant people. As we were developing this bill, we looked closely at Argentina's law and other models that existed, working closely with our national civil society organizations, as well as regional NGOs such as Transgender Europe and the European chapter of the International Intersex Organization. This partnership proved most useful, as with every conversation that was had, we were able to improve the scope of the legislation. This in order to fulfill a simple goal, that is, that of making people's lives better and alleviating unnecessary suffering. Following our collective efforts in 2015, the Gender Identity, Gender Expression and Sex Characteristics Act was adopted with the support of both sides of the House of Parliament. Through this law, all persons are now able to change the name and align their gender on official documents following a notarial declaration, which changes cannot take any longer than the legally prescribed maximum of 30 days to take effect. We have also protected all persons against unnecessary, unconsented and uninformed medical and surgical interventions on their sex characteristics. And social or cultural factors for such interventions are strictly banned. My government has subsequently introduced school and prison policies for trans, intersex, and gender variant people, addressing a range of issues that are relevant to this cohort in those institutions. At the end of last year, then, we introduced a law affirming all sexual orientations, gender identities, and gender expressions as equally valid and banned so-called conversion practices. Through a parallel law, we also depathologized sexual orientation, gender identity, and gender expression across the board. In the coming weeks, we will be rolling out passports and ID cards that allow persons to choose a gender marker beyond the binary, and instead of an M or an F, opt for an X. I often get asked questions like, why Malta, or how could you do this so fast? I don't think this is fast at all. On the contrary, I think what we did was long overdue. I honestly think that a more pertinent question would be, what were we waiting for to address sex, intersex, and gender variant people's rights as human rights? Indeed, these persons suffer some of the most severe human rights abuses around the world, ranging from extreme violence from their own family to persons unknown to them. Discrimination in various spheres of life, lack of recognition of their personhood, to denial of or forced medical treatments. In short, trans, intersex, and gender variant people deserve our political attention. If in Malta we did what we did, notwithstanding our conservative culture, then surely other countries may register progress in this field as well. Some people may wonder whether this side event fits within the context of the CSW. The answer is simple. It fits perfectly, as trans, intersex, and gender variant people suffer because of patriarchy and gender stereotypes, much like women do. Their fight for equality and women's fight for equality are thus, by their very nature, the same fight. And therefore, I believe that it is important that future CSWs address the rights of trans, intersex, and gender variant people more centrally in the main program. I thank you.
Thank you, Minister. Unfortunately, the Minister has to leave us shortly because being CSW, it's very busy time, particularly given the UN's going to be closed tomorrow. So moving on, we're going to now hear from Martín García Moritán, who is the permanent representative of Argentina to the United Nations. And I'm looking forward to hearing what you're going to tell us about Argentina also being a bit of a world leader.
Thank you so much, and distinguished guests. Good afternoon, and thank you very much for coming. Let me begin by thanking the Permanent Mission of Malta to the United Nations for putting together this interest panel in a topic so new and so important for the main theme of this year, CSW Agree Conclusions. For Argentina, as co-chair of the LGBT core group in New York, it is an honor to be able to co-sponsor this event and to present our perspective and experience in relation with the legal protection of trans people. When in 2012 Argentina was the first country to adopt a specific legislation on gender identity, breaking away from a medical perspective and focusing in the self-identification, the whole world spoke about it. Today, many other countries are moving in the same direction and going even further in the recognition and promotion of rights of trans people. There is even a pending advisory opinion requested by Costa Rica to the Inter-American Court of Human Rights, which will clarify the level of protection that the states have to give to trans people according to our regional human rights law. The enactment of the Gender Identity Act has been a fundamental step for the visibility, identity, and integration of trans people in our communities, due to its acknowledgement of the right of all trans people to recognize their self-perceived gender identity and to receive a dignified treatment. The law was groundbreaking as it recognized the right of trans people to be identified in all public documents, including birth certificates and the national ID, accordingly to their gender identity, without any precondition of surgical intervention, hormonal therapies, or other psychological or medical treatment. As a main consequence, the law managed to bring a new perspective on the recognition of the rights of trans people out of medical pathological view, avoiding long judicial procedures and fighting indirectly stigmatization. I would also like to mention briefly other important laws that were enacted recently in Argentina, helping to improve the legal protection of trans people. The Assisted Reproduction Act of 2013 includes provisions granting comprehensive access to medically assisted reproductive procedures and techniques to all persons of legal age, without any limitation or discrimination based on sexual orientation, gender identity, or civil status. The Mental Health Act also specifically states that in under no circumstance a diagnosis in the field of mental health can be made only on the basis of the sexual choice or identity. The new civil code adopted in 2015 acknowledges the right to gender identity, considering it a just reason not to change in any public document the name and registered sex without the need to resort to judicial authorization. Besides, on the chapter related to filiation, it includes the concept of procreational will, granting equal rights of all children regardless of the sexual orientation, gender identity, or marital status of the parents. To conclude, I want to mention new legislation being enacted by some local government in Argentina seeking to grant that a percentage of all new jobs in the public sector for trans people. Those percentages go from 1% to 5% depending on the jurisdiction and tend to solve an urgent problem of access to work of trans people and equal opportunities in a society where until recently they were mostly rejected from the formal economy. The challenges ahead of us for the full legal recognition of the rights of trans, intersex, and gender variant people are several and require a lot of creative legal work and strong leadership. We hope to keep on exchanging views and best practices in this and other international fora in order to be able to keep on moving in the right direction. Thank you.
Thank you, Ambassador. And your gender pronoun is?
He.
Thank you. And now moving on, we're going to hear from Maria Ruotanen, who is Director of Human Dignity and Equality for the Council of Europe, which has made these issues quite a priority. Perhaps you could tell us a little bit about that. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So I'm she. And as you already mentioned, I'm representing the Council of Europe, which is a regional organization with 47 member states. So I also would like to say, although we are co-organizers of the event, also congratulate us, because I couldn't agree more with the minister that this is a topic that we have to make more and more visible at the meetings of the CSW. And I'm very happy that we are breaking now this way, and I would like to be one of those also with the Council of Europe who will make sure that it will stay on the agenda. Because I think it's very important not to forget that what is the protection of human rights of trans, intersex, and gender identity people as well. And we have to bring it very, very visible. So for the Council of Europe, the issue is very, very clear. The trans rights and intersex rights are human rights. Gender identity is a prohibited ground of discrimination under Article 14 of the European Convention of Human Rights. So that means that trans and intersex people have the same rights as everybody else. And in order to achieve that, we need to combat to phobia, whether it's transphobia, intersex phobia, and discrimination against these persons. And the ways that the Council of Europe is actually working to protect these rights is laid down in a recommendation that the Committee of Ministers adopted 7 years ago. And it's a recommendation that deals with measures to combat discrimination on grounds of sexual orientation or sexual identity. And it's a recommendation that is very, I would say, like a catalogue of practices, very detailed. And it deals with a variety of issues ranging from the protection from violence and freedom of association and assembly to respect for different aspects of private life, such as employment, education, health, housing, sports, etc. And it deals also with multiple discrimination. And this recommendation was adopted by, as I said, the Committee of Ministers, the 47 member states, and it's applicable to the 47 member states of the Council of Europe. And this recommendation is actually based on the case law of the European Court of Human Rights. And we will be really using now also the case law that comes out in the coming years and hope that will guide us even more in our actions that we will be taking. So how does the Council of Europe support the member states in ensuring that they implement these provisions? Well, we have different ways of doing it. We have, for example, quite a few of monitoring mechanisms at the Council of Europe. And today you can see more and more of these monitoring mechanisms in a transversal way to try to see and to ensure that the rights of the trans, intersex, and gender variant people are also respected. One example for example, we have a committee on prevention of torture that visits places of detention. And they have now looked into the rights of transgender prisoners. And they are coming up, of course, in their evaluation reports with information that we were very, very much lacking before. So that is one example. We have also a commission on racism that examines the situation in the member states, all the 47 member states, and now they are in the fifth cycle of monitoring, and one of the very focus area that they are looking into it is the issues of trans and intersex people. So I think this is information that we will be getting more and more, and that is a way for us also in the Council to see, okay, what are the challenges that the member states are facing in implementing these provisions. On the other hand, we are also trying to support member states in exchanging good practices, because this is a way of learning from one another. I think it's a very efficient way of seeing, okay, what can we learn from them and how we can maybe do it better in our country. And we, of course, learned from Minister Dalli before the excellent example of Malta. And we have actually tried to use also this Maltese excellent example, for example, in assisting the Greek authorities in drafting their new law on legal gender recognition. We are also trying to see in different ways, on a transversal way, how we can help and address especially the question of multiple discrimination. So we are trying to put accent on different groups that are really the most vulnerable in all these situations, not to mention, for example, not to mention all of them, but we are putting a lot of focus especially on the Roma community. And I think the moderator, when you started, you mentioned especially some hate crime issues, and I think it's especially in Europe, but I'm sure everywhere, we see this being a big, big challenge. And we are now noticing that although we see that there is maybe quite a lot of rules in place, but there is a lot of challenges in European countries in putting these rules in practice. And we see especially that we have, although we have out of the Council of Europe, more than half have a specific criminal legislation in place to punish offences motivated by hate. But what is worrying is that there is a failing to properly implement these laws. And of course, there is a lot of support that the Council of Europe can give in that, but it's a long road ahead we still have. So I would say that the hate crime is one of the challenges that we really need to address. But now to address that, I think events like this, to start with, they are important because it is the awareness, or maybe also the shame or the the secrecy that can still be too much around these issues that is leading people to act the way they act. And I think the Council of Europe is really trying to now put more accent on awareness raising and also, of course, to tackle the question of the hate crime. Well, maybe you stop there because I think there is still a long list of speakers. Thank you.
Thank you. Next up, we have Purnason, who is the Policy Director for UN Women. And perhaps you could tell us a little bit about how these issues fit with the wider equality agenda of UN Women.
Thank you very much, Chair. I'm happy to talk about that. I'd like to first apologise because I'm losing my voice, so I hope it will last for this session. But also to say I'm here on behalf of our Executive Director, Pumzile Mlambo Nkuka. She is very much committed to moving this agenda forward and is very clear that it is a priority for us and has tasked us with speeding things along. She's pleased I'm here and she sends her greetings, which I'd like to convey to you. I'd like to acknowledge the countries that are here, the excellencies, distinguished guests, and others who share this agenda today that we take forward together. You mentioned, Chair, earlier the recent killing in Brazil, and that was actually going to be my opening remark. I think that's a very chilling and clear reminder of the times in which we live. I understand it was the fifth killing within a week or so of within the month of a trans person. Dandara dos Santos, I believe, was not the first, but one of a series of killings that ought to concern us all. I find it worrying that not just that it can happen. I haven't watched the video. I don't intend to watch the video. I've seen enough stills to know, and I've read the accounts. There was no intervention there. People filmed and people shared, and nobody intervened. And this person was taken and was killed. I think we live in a climate of very frightening social approval of this sort of behavior and of the dehumanization of people who do not fit categories of humans that we approve of. And for me, I think the fundamental problem is who counts as human, and that's what I want to come back to in a moment. It's really not very difficult. Mario, you said it's a question of human rights. It's really not a difficult concept. Protecting LGBTI people from violence and discrimination really ought to be a fundamental principle. It's enshrined in international human rights law. If you go back to the Universal Declaration, it says very clearly, and I quote, "All human beings are born free and equal in dignity and rights." I'm sure we all know this language. "And everyone is entitled to all the rights without distinction of any kind," and then there's a list. Really, it's not rocket science. And I think the reason why this whole area is so sticky is there is contestation of who constitutes a human, who should be entitled to those rights and the freedoms that we all should enjoy. Unfortunately, none of the 9 existing key and core human rights treaties specifically and explicitly mention sexual orientation, gender identity and expression, or sex characteristics as prohibitive grounds of discrimination. But in the jurisprudence and in general comments and in concluding observations, UN treaty bodies have repeatedly held that sexual orientation, gender identity and expression, and sex characteristics are prohibited grounds of discrimination under international law. So it seems to me we have the principles very clearly. And the challenge is to ensure that principles are held and that they are made real in the lives of people who are denied their full humanity. And it's clear that where we have got progress, for example, the fantastic example of Malta has been cited, but also other countries have made great progress. New anti-discrimination laws have been introduced, and we pay credit to the countries that have led. the way. But it is clear, I think, that global developments such as these are overshadowed by human rights and abuses being carried out against individuals worldwide based on their actual or perceived sexual orientation and identity. And I think at this point it's worth remembering that we're working in a context where all human rights and activists are being challenged. There is a battle being waged on women's rights. There's a battle being waged around human rights activists. It is not safe. It is not easy to get funding. It is not easy to remain autonomous in organization. And I think at this point, how it is that we A, hold firm to the gains that have been won, and there are some, and there are not enough, and they are not fast enough, but there are some, and how we ensure that in this quite adverse context, we can continue to move forward. For me, those are the big challenges we face now. At UN Women, we're dealing with some of those conversations because the pushback on women's rights is very, very keen. It's very sharp. We know there's a pushback on sexual and reproductive rights. We know there's a demonization of refugees and migrants. We know that human rights activists are unsafe. What we have to do is ensure that our fundamental truths and our humanity that we share become our common cause and become our rallying cry and our activism and our work. For UN Women, you asked me to say what UN Women is doing. I've been there a year and a half, and I think I will have met some of you at various meetings where you've come and said, get on with it, quite rightly. And I will not say that we're getting on with it fast enough, but I will say that some things are moving. We spoke to you earlier about developing a guidance note for our colleagues on practice and programming. That is now drafted. It's going through an internal approval stage and will go out for further comment. And we hope that you will also find time to comment on it. We will be sharing it with you and seeking your feedback. That will help our colleagues, both in head office and in country offices, to shape the nature of interactions and programming and other work they do in country around these issues and around rights broadly. For example, we have initiatives and work in Brazil, in South Africa, in Fiji, Malawi, Vietnam, and other places which are either building and supporting the capacity of NGOs who are working on these issues, or looking at knowledge and awareness building around violence against particular people, and supporting other initiatives to end such abuses and violence. These are initiatives that are already underway. The guidance note is intended to provide a solid human rights framing that is clear and accessible to everybody for their work as it goes ahead, and hopefully there will be more of it. I'm sure there's impatience in the room. I believe that you've been having this discussion with UN Women for some years now. I'm hoping we're speeding it up and that we will continue to engage in a conversation with you where you push us because it's needed, and where we respond and move forward more quickly than we have done. So what I want to do then is just to commit to you at this stage that this will go ahead, commit to you that we continue to take this seriously, and that we will be looking to talk to you more in detail about a guidance note that will shape our work much more specifically over the next period, and to ensure that the bigger project of ensuring that all people are recognized as fully human, not least of all intersex and trans and other folks who've really been denied visibility and hearing and the ability to be heard, rather, that they are particularly placed centre stage. That's our challenge now, I think. We very much welcome the appointment of the new, now what's his proper title? Is it its new title?
Independent expert.
And he is such a fantastic activist and scholar with incredible credentials. I'm very hopeful that he will make a difference, and we will commit to working with him to take this work forward. Thank you very much.
Thank you. And that guidance note, when that's opened up to comment, that can be found on the UN Women website?
I think we'll send it out.
You'll send it out? Okay.
Yeah.
It will be arranged. Stay tuned. Now we're going to hear a little bit about the situation on the ground from First of all, from Micah. I'm just going to call you Micah G. I'm not going to even attempt to pronounce your last name. You can help me with that. And Micah is an international advocacy advisor for the Swedish Federation for Lesbian, Gay, Bisexual, Transgender and Queer Rights.
Thank you. At some point, we were joking with my colleagues that I should just go as Micah G, and at least people would understand and remember. But my full name is Micah Grzywnowicz. My pronoun that I use is they. And just before I go on the ground and share some of the examples from my work and what I experience while working in those spaces at the UN, I would like to unpack the term trans and gender identity because there is a lot, I think it will help us in our work further. So I think what you were referring to, all the violence and what's going on, I think it's very important to mention it and that it happens. I think what is even more important is to talk why it happens, where it comes from, all the root causes. So I will just combine those two and then move to the UN spaces. From my work, I experience a lot of times that when we hear word trans or gender identity, we think still very binary. We think about trans men and trans women. So we just, I like to say, we exchange boxes that are provided for us by the system. And this creates a lot of challenges for people who choose not to identify with either of the genders. And where it comes from, where the consequences of breaking this norm comes from. Our system is built on the binary. It only accepts two genders. You're either feminine or masculine. If you're a woman, you're a feminine person. If you're a man, you're a masculine. Also, we are very much focused what genitals means. If you have one set of genitals, you're one type of identity and so on. And these assumptions create a lot of problems for people who don't fit the roles or the expectations from the society. From violence to discrimination, being excluded from families and so on. And we have a lot of data, we have some data, I shouldn't say a lot of data because we have not enough data. When it comes to discrimination and violence faced by trans people. And I digged a bit to find information about if there is some difference between experiences of gender variant or non-binary persons experiencing violence or discrimination. And actually there is quite a big difference. And I will give you some numbers. So for instance, comparing trans persons' experience with suffering physical assault, 25% of trans persons would report to a survey that they do. When it comes to non-binary persons, it was 32%, so it was much higher. The same goes with experiencing police brutality or harassment. It was 31% versus 21%, so again, much more, much higher. Medical treatment situations or discrimination, 36% of gender non-binary people faced discrimination in medical setting versus 27%. And what really shocked me was data on reporting of hate-motivated violence. So from people who took part in the survey that I'm referring to a few years back, almost 74% of people who faced hate-motivated violence didn't go to the police. 74%. And the explanation given was that they are worried and scared of going to the police because they would face even more discrimination and violence. And one may think like, okay, so why would a person not go and talk to, you know, authorities that are supposed to protect us. And it goes back to the whole, you know, assumptions, who you are and how you look and what the person in front of you assume how you should be. Another issue we were mentioning, issuing ID cards and having more options than female and male. And I think it's a really, really wonderful thing to provide people with more choices than the two. We also need, however, we need to be very careful how we introduce those new systems, because there are only a handful of countries who provide the option and everybody else don't know how to deal with it. So people face a lot of challenges traveling, for instance, because officers at passport controls get the passport with X or O, and people face issues. So I think collectively we need to address as well that. So as outlining the issues, how the UN system addressed it or answered to bringing up issues of gender non-conforming persons. Treaty bodies were mentioned earlier. I would like to give you two examples of special rapporteurs. One was a special rapporteur on torture, which specifically addressed issues faced by gender non-conforming persons in detention centers. And it was specifically said that those individuals face even more, they are more exposed more to violence and discrimination because of their gender identity and gender expression and not fitting in one or the other. And they are targets of gender-based violence. Similar findings and remarks were given by Special Rapporteur on safe drinking water and sanitation. This addressed access to bathrooms, you know, what rights a gender non-conforming person need to give up to actually go to the toilet, from, you know, humiliation, dignity. People choose not to go to the bathroom or choose to conceal their identities. So I think when we talk about protecting transgender variant and intersex person, I think we need to broaden the understanding what gender means in general, and how it all fits and how it can, how the system that we are creating can actually serve everybody and not just the ones who fit in the system that we created for now. Thank you.
Thank you, Micah. That's a very interesting and good point you make about passports and traveling, and particularly given the difficulties that we all face getting into certain countries anyway at the moment. Now we're going to move on to Zhan Chiam, Senior Program Officer with the International Lesbian, Gay, Bisexual, Trans and Intersex Association. Thanks.
Hello. Hello, everyone. So as Michelle mentioned, my name is Zhan. My gender pronouns are he and him. And I work at ILGA, which is the Global Federation of LGBTI Associations, and I run the Gender Identity and Expression Program. I thought, as a contrast to Micah's presentation, that I would talk about national implementation, national laws, when it comes to recognizing trans people's legal rights in relation to, more specifically, legal gender recognition. Now, legal gender recognition is vitally important because it is what allows a person to exist as a legal entity in society. It allows them to open a bank account, allows them to go to school, allows them to cross borders, allows them to get married. So it covers a whole range of issues. But I just want to step back from that and say that although, of course, the Argentinian example and the Maltese examples are fantastic examples, they are in their context. And what works for those two countries doesn't necessarily work for other countries. So we should keep that in mind as well when we think about legal gender recognition. So last year, ILGA published our first translegal mapping report, which was a desk review. We ended up with 111 countries, two volunteers and myself working on collecting data, and as far as we could, the lived experiences of trans people in relation to legal gender recognition. I want to pull back and say, when we talk about legal gender recognition, I'm not just talking about changing your gender marker to M, F, X, or O, but I'm also talking about changing your name. And why do I say that? It's because in many countries in the world, changing, if gender marker change is available, that's fine, but it can be often more prohibitive than a name change process. So it can ask for a whole bunch of problematic requirements that impact on a person's fundamental human rights. So what human rights am I talking about? I'm talking about the right to privacy. I'm talking about self-determination. And I'll unpack those things. And recognition before the law. Gender marker change processes can also often be extremely timely, extremely invasive, whereas name change processes often are quicker, though not necessarily always the case. So I just want to say that when we talk about legal gender recognition, we're talking about those two parallel processes. Now, what does a good legal gender recognition law look like? You know, it should be based on internationally accepted human rights standards. It should be non-pathologizing, which means that it should not require a trans person to be diagnosed with a medical disorder in order to go through the process. It should not have surgical requirements, which can be lower surgery, upper surgery, or a combination of those things. It should be based on self-determination, like I said, and it should have third gender options. And it should be accessible in terms of people knowing how to use it. So the law is the law, that's fine, but do trans communities know about the law? And for this, I also want to say that very often when we're talking about legal gender recognition, we're not talking about legislation. We're also talking about case law. We're talking about administrative rules or processes, and we're talking about policies. And some of these things are not transparent in countries. And finally, legal gender recognition should be uniform across a country, which means that what's available at the federal level, for example, if there is a split system like that, is also, you know, available at the state level and vice versa. So it should not just take place at the federal government level, but it should move down into the provinces, the states, the cantons. Okay, so I just want to give you a few examples of legal gender recognition processes around the world. So India, there was a landmark case in India which looked at the rights of trans people called the NALSA decision in 2014. And it was a very progressive decision, but there's been problems with implementing the recommendations to the government in the Indian two houses of, well, the upper house, it passed, but then now the lower house has stalled the bill, which is regressive in a lot of its approaches. I mean, the Indian example as well is unique because you're also looking at a community where there is a cultural third gender identity, which is separate to the male-female identities. Then you have countries which might surprise you. For example, Poland has a legal gender recognition process, but it still maintains a system whereby the person who wants to change their legal gender has to effectively sue their parents in a civil suit by saying that, you know, so it's a process that's contentious in amongst the family itself in order for the person then to achieve legal gender recognition. China also has legal gender recognition processes, which is also very restrictive. And in addition to the ordinary requirements that you often see, it also requires the consent of the person's family because your identity is kept in a family register book, and so your family has to consent to your gender marker change. Then you have ex-Soviet, some of the ex-Soviet countries, the most infamous of which was Ukraine, which recently changed a process which required a person who wanted to change their gender marker before they started the process to be put in a psychiatric institution for up to 45 days to be observed to see whether they were suitable to go through the process. So this was a really problematic, of course, requirement, but that has recently, very recently, been repealed, which is great. And then if we take a look at Africa, there's only two countries which allow legal gender recognition, Namibia and South Africa. But then they're very restrictive in their requirements. And for South Africa, for example, it requires a person, well, there are extremely long waiting periods for the administrative process to be completed. So trans activists there say it can take up to 7 years to wait for the administrative process. There isn't a requirement, but there's an application of a misunderstanding of the requirement in South Africa that people need to have surgery, and that's actually not the case, but it's understood by the administrative staff who police this law that that is the case. And then finally, I want to talk about legal gender recognition as it impacts on other laws and other rights in society. And I think that this is a really great opportunity for us to think about gender in society and how it's legislated as a whole and what we think about gender in society. So, for example, you may have a country which has a legal gender recognition process and it allows people to change their gender marker. But then that same country may have in its criminal provisions rape laws, which still define rape, you know, in a very restrictive binary way, and may, for example, define rape as something that involves, female, cisgender female body parts, for example. So, you know, the laws then don't meet easily, and trans people, even though they can access legal gender recognition, they then are discriminated against, and the laws in their country don't continue to protect them at different stages of their lives. If you look at countries that for which there is a strong inheritance culture, so for example, India or Pakistan, you inherit property sometimes based on your gender. So if you can change your gender to another gender, how does that impact on your gender, on your inheritance rights? If you have an X marker in one of those countries, you know, does inheritance law in that country actually recognize that? If you can change your name, are they then able to change the name on the inheritance document that says that you then continue to inherit property? So these are just a few of the problems. And then I wanted to talk about, just very quickly, a couple of new examples that have come up. So in Vietnam, there was recently passed a new legal gender recognition law, which is great, but it has surgical and sterilization requirements. But activists there have said, they're happy with it at this stage, and then they will work to try and improve the situation there. Norway last year passed a really good law on legal gender recognition, which didn't have prohibitive requirements. So I think I'll stop there, and maybe we can just discuss this more when we have questions. Thank you.
Thanks, Zhan. We're going to throw the floor open to questions now. We've got about 15 minutes or so. If you could state your name and where you're from, and preferably who you are directing your question to, that would be great. Just here in the front.
Hi. Can everyone hear me? Is that working?
Yeah.
My name is Megan. I go by she. I represent the International Relations Student Association at McGill University from Canada. And my question just centers around the issue of access versus stigma. So in the DSM, Diagnostic Statistical Manual of Mental Health, gender dysphoria is still considered a mental disorder. So whilst many argue that this contributes to stigma, some also argue that it means that in places without universal health care that people can get access to coverage for really expensive medical procedures for trans people that they otherwise wouldn't be able to access. because they can cite a diagnosis. So how, I'm asking anyone on the panel, how would you reconcile this trade-off, and what are your thoughts on this issue of access versus stigma? Thank you.
Hi, thanks for the question. So the DSM is one model that's being used. The other one is the International Classification of Diseases, which that, looks not just at mental, but also at physical things affecting your body. The ICD is undergoing reform from ICD-10 to ICD-11. In that, trans communities proposed that that there is a chapter that does not stigmatize, and that there is a definition. So it's, the proposal is to pull it out of the mental and behavioral disorder chapter and put it into another chapter that is not stigmatizing. It will still be, hopefully, if the chapter is born, then it will still allow people to access insurance, health insurance benefits, which is really important for trans communities. So I totally agree with what you say, that we still need to have these codes at this stage because it gives trans people access to healthcare. But we are completely behind depathologizing, like you're saying, trans identities and stigmatizing them.
Would anyone else like to answer? We're good. Any other questions? Just you?
Thank you. My name is Joyce Hamilton, with CUC Netherlands Dutch LGBT organization, and I have a question for both Micah and Zhan on the options, the third options. There are some countries that have or that have been started offering a third option, and I was just wondering if you could explain a little bit more what, how, in what circumstances that might be helpful for people, and also what the disadvantages or the potential negative impact could be of using such categories.
Thank you, Joyce. I guess, like I was saying in the opening remarks, I think it's always better to have more options than the two, because we know that there are people who don't fit and they don't want to fit in the two. And the system around forces us to choose. So either, you know, by having very gendered names or having surgeries to fit to those. And there are a few examples of laws that provide the third option. So for instance, there is, I will give an example of not such a good law that was introduced in Germany, which, you know, suggest or provided an option for parents to choose another option for their intersex kids. But that was only given for intersex children, which by kind of default exposed them even more, because that kind of revealed their identity. So that's not what we want to provide for people. And that it was not given, that the option was not given for trans people, for adults or otherwise. And I think Silvan can comment more on that example. But then also, like, to what Zhan was saying, you know, how the laws that we want to improve, so that, you know, for instance, to have three options on your passport, how they impact on everything else. So the travels, employment, you know, if people, if I have a third gender on my passport and I travel to another country, can I be employed? Can I access the country? You know, like, what it actually means in practice. So it's always good to have more options. It's just we need to figure out how to handle the system that we're creating. Silvan, do you want to comment?
Yeah. Well, in the German case, indeed, the moment that an intersex infant is identified, so a baby is identified as intersex, the doctor has no choice but to register that baby as an X, and that, of course, is very problematic. In our case, when we looked at the issue of intersex persons and who were developing the Maltese law. We wanted to ensure that there is a model that allows children to develop before a gender was ascribed to them one way or the other. So in the Gender Identity, Gender Expression and Sex Characteristics Act, parents are provided, and these are all parents, not only parents of intersex children, but with the possibility of not registering a gender marker until the age of 18 of that child, so that child can grow without a gender marker altogether. And following a recent amendment in our law, the parents won't even need to go to court in order for them to inscribe a gender marker once a gender is known, because that child, once it's at the age of 16, can decide, so it would be an adolescent by that time, can decide for himself, herself, or themselves what gender marker is most suitable by going to the notary, that's the model that we have, and a notarial deed, and declare their own gender themselves. So that was, for us, the most suitable that we could find. We still have a model that is based on the gender binary in terms of our public registry system, and it wasn't something that when we were adopting the law, it's funny how it becomes almost very old after only 2 years, but when that it was very important for the community to have a gender marker beyond the binary in terms of the birth certificate. But it is important in order for the identification cards and for passports now, also because those, if you will, would be not revealing the gender marker on the birth certificate by having an X. So allowing the person to be without having to expose the gender marker on the birth certificate.
Just to play a bit of devil's advocate here. I had a conversation a few days ago about, you know, why do we need an M or an F or an X on our passports? I'm not saying to get rid of gender, so just to clarify, because they are two different conversations. But on our documents, we have a picture that looks like us. We have a name that we supposedly agree with, and we can change if we don't. We have whatever number of identification that the state gives us, and whatever information there are, fingerprints and all that. Why do we need a letter that defines our gender? Because a lot of times trans people, gender non-conforming people, intersex persons get in trouble because that little letter doesn't correspond with how they look. So maybe, you know, when we talk about passport, maybe one of the options would be just to take out that little letter.
Not a bad suggestion. Anyone else have a question?
If I may, actually, I would like to comment on this one, because
we'll just let Daisy go back and forth.
Yes, but it will be my last intervention on this subject. The thing is this, that when it comes to identification documents, that's fully within the remit of the country to include a gender marker or otherwise. So, for example, German identification documents don't have a gender marker and have not had one since a very long time. So on this front, Germany is very progressive, and like Germany, also the Netherlands, for example, did not have a letter, male, female, whatever. That changed when the European Union adopted a more harmonized identification card. But when it comes to passports, it's a bit more complex, because countries don't really have the choice of whether to leave it out by themselves or inscribe it by themselves, because it's regulated internationally. So we would need to have a change on the global level before countries can decide to keep or omit. So it's indeed, conversations at this level are very important, because
they can open the doors for a conversation about whether it's really necessary or otherwise. But I don't think that this is something that is going to happen in the very short term. It's going to be more medium term or long term.
Thank you. Question just here.
Thank you. My name is Adrian Coman. I work for a private foundation in New York called Arcas Foundation. I would first like to thank you all for all your efforts in all your environments on a topic which is not very well known. And I have two questions, if possible. One for Mr. Agius. What kind of messages do you have for the Maltese public on this topic, you know? And what do you hear back from the Maltese people? And the second question would be for Micah and Zhan or Mr. Chiam and I can say Mr. right with they, Grzywnowicz. I can pronounce
or
the name.
Or you can do the mix.
Okay.
MX.
What keeps you optimistic in this work? Thank you.
So the Maltese public has been very supportive of all these transformations in recent times. It's something that was promised prior to the last election, and it's something that then government followed through during its mandate. I think one major change that has happened in this field was the moving away from this notion of politicians providing handouts to people in terms of a bit of this and a bit of that, but you always have to concede something, to a movement towards a culture of rights. So the Maltese public has responded really positively to this, and I think the vast majority of people today would very comfortably say, yes, of course, transgender people should have their rights. Yes, of course, we should stop medical interventions on intersex babies and infants. And yes, we should allow genderqueer persons to live their lives the way they feel that they should live them. So the message to the Maltese public has been consistent, that of rights, that of equality, that of also loving thy neighbor as thyself. And it really was framed also to some degree into this Catholic understanding of love. And I don't say that by mistake. It really has been very much in this sense of brotherly love. And many people in Malta, of course, are Catholic and will support these rights as part of the extension of this sense of respecting others like you would want to have yourself respected. So I think it's very important for politicians to show their political will in this area, and also to have a strong civil society. Indeed, our success story has been that of this synthesis, this work together. We have an LGBTIQ consultative council constituted by government that comprises all LGBTIQ civil society. So there are regular meetings where people meet, they express their views, set out the agenda of what needs to be addressed next. And the result is always positive because it's built on real experiences of people and not built around, political expediency, or we can only concede this much this time around and maybe we can address some other point next time, or this is the best you can get now, we won't give you more. It's not phrased like that. It's not formulated like that. And this has also opened up the space then for the people to realize that around them there have always been many LGBTIQ persons, with people coming out with people being more free to express themselves. And also we've had advocates that you would not usually expect to have. Children, for example, coming out as transgender in schools, and then speaking about their experience also on national TV, perhaps. And that has turned things around a lot. People have realized that this is not something that, happens because some people just want to be different or out of, I don't know, some personal choice, but it really is intrinsic to the individual. And that, has changed the discourse a lot in the country.
And just maybe some short remarks.
Thank you for this question. I love it. Just one example, what actually gave me a lot of energy for, I think, few months or at least few years, the whole process around independent expert and how, you know, organizations from so many countries came together to advocate for that. We had created a sign-on letter leading up to the vote at the Human Rights Council, and we had more than 600 organizations from 156 countries signing on to that letter that mandate is necessary. And it happened. It was huge. It is huge. And, you know, just 5 years ago, I don't think we would have that conversation or that success. So things are not easy. The context is not easy. But I think we have a lot of examples of great work and, as I call it, global teamwork constantly in those spaces. So.
Thank you. Unfortunately, we're going to have to wrap it up there. Silvan, who is the Director of Human Rights and Integration Directorate for Malta, had some concluding remarks. We're good? Okay. Thank you all for coming. Thank you to our panelists. This was a really fascinating discussion. Lots of work ahead for everyone, and stay safe tomorrow in the snow. Thank you.